KW Intersections. Thank you all for coming also still during the March break. We will have two talks today. So Joachim Sofini will be doing the first talk, Shinan will be doing the second talk. The topic about the first talk will be engineering basic quantum systems, and therefore we will need to build delicate systems that are governed by the rules of quantum physics. And Joachim will be actually talking more about how you build a functional neutron interferometry system. So give them all a welcome applause.
Thank you all for coming. I'm glad I didn't stay before with the title of my talk. But initially, I was thinking that I would give a talk more on the things that I'm currently working on. So I'm a postdoc at the Institute of Quantum Computing, where I actually completed my PhD last year. And I'm working on transformative quantum technologies. So I have work that probably could have interest some people, but because it's not published, I decided otherwise that I would talk about it. So I'll talk about the segment of the work that I'll be talking about today is basically part of my PhD thesis. So I'll give, basically the way I will structure my talk is that I will give you the motivation as to why we really care about quantum system. And then I'll tell you specifically the quantum system that I looked into. And then I'll take you through an introduction on how this system actually works. And then show you how two projects spring from this introduction. And those projects will be one on quantum random walks, and then there will be one on noise free interferometry, and then I will conclude. So let me start by asking you a question. Like when you hear of quantum system, what immediately comes to your mind? Like, we all have different ideas. Maybe you can think of a low temperature system like this one, or some people immediately think of the quantum computer.
Photosynthesis in plants.
Yes, exactly. There is a lot of research that is getting into quantum biology. And then, or you think of it a quantum computer, then you immediately think of computers that can break the current cryptographic system that we use, or we build computers with quantum cryptography. And therefore, what I would try to tell you, what is unique to all of these quantum systems is that what I will focus on today, we'll be looking at these quantum systems, and they are quite big systems. So if you have to build a quantum computer, you will have to build it with many units. And first I will distinguish how a quantum system differs from a classical system. So you have, in a classical system, you think of encoding information in terms of ones and zeros. So you have abstraction in terms of zeros and like it can be a low or a high voltage. And then you can either have a zero or a one. In a quantum system, you will have a superposition of this, which you cannot specifically tell if you are either in a zero or a one. So you have a zero and a one, and then you have a state that is neither a zero nor a one, but if you perform a measurement, and I'll explain to you what a measurement is, different ways of measurement, then you can tell that the system is actually in the zero state or in the one state. And here, this animation is showing you, like, if you have a quantum system and a classical system. So you see that in a classical system, you are performing computation by repeating this structure, and you have a trajectory or a path. So you actually can go in each of the paths. And then in a quantum case, you can also go in various paths. But the distinction is that these paths, they are all happening at the same time. You cannot distinguish the path that you took. And subsequently, I'll describe this more. So the motivation behind my work is, if we want to build a big quantum system, then a quantum system is built on these quantum bits, which I'll refer to as qubits. You have to build a system by stacking or connecting many of these quantum bits. And they'll be talking to one another. And because they talk to one another, you will have effects that will be affecting the system by the way they communicate might not be accurate, and you will need to ensure that they are communicating in a proper way, or effects of the environment are not affected, maybe to like temperature or noise. So the focus of my work was to isolate a single quantum system, which is the tiniest unit that you will have, and then look at how we can engineer this system, make this system as good as possible. By understanding this single unit, we can then understand how we can build multiple units and connect together. So, and then also focus on taking these tiny units, how can it be useful? So rather than just thinking of building a quantum computer, the technology behind a quantum computer has led to several other devices, which are not really quantum computers, but they are very useful. That's part of what I'll be trying to talk about today. So this, just a note, implementation of quantum system, despite the fact that the abstractions are all the same, you can implement it in different type of system. And the system that I worked on is called interferometry. And the motivation behind interferometry, why we use interferometry, is that in interferometry, you can, when you perform it with particles, especially those that have mass, you can actually send these particles inside a material and you measure the structure of the material. So you can measure quantities that are very useful in characterizing material. What we use commonly referred to as condensed matter. You can equally measure quantities that are of significant importance in standard model physics, and then you can perform metrology. And when you look at metrology in this quantum system, which is the neutron interferometer, you realize that you can perform measurements in which you can break the signal, you can improve the signal to noise ratio compared to what you obtain in a normal classical system. And what one of the work that we actually came up with is something which looks like this. This is a system that we built, which is based on Ramsey interferometer. And we actually have a pattern that is five for this. So I'll continue, start by walking you through on how an interferometer works. So an interferometer is made up of three basic components here. I have a beam splitter, I have a mirror, and then I have a phase bar. So basically the way a beam splitter works is that you send a laser light. You can think of it as a partial mirror. You send a beam on a partial mirror, part of it is transmitted and part of it is reflected. And if you send from the other direction, you can have a similar process happen, and you can send from both directions. Then here is a mirror that is actually coated, so when you send the beam, it's completely reflected. Then we look at the phase plot. This is the one that is a little bit difficult to explain today. Common way, but the one way to think about it is that when you send this wave through this material, which I think it's a uniform density material, the structure of the wave inside, because it's a particle, it's propagating as a wave, so the structure inside is modified. And I'm comparing here the wave that is propagating outside the sample and the one that is propagating inside. And you can see that the one that is propagating inside is modified. So the distance between these two peaks increases, and that leads to a decrease in the velocity. So the particle actually, or the waves actually slows down inside. And a common way to think about it, so to characterize that how this thing does this, we use what is called a refractive index. And actually light is refractive, water refracts light, and the way you can think of it is when you put your hand in a pool of water, you see that your arm appears to be bent. That's actually a refraction. So we use the same principle here. So if we combine these elements, we put these elements together, then we can form this structure. And this is commonly, this one geometry is referred to as the Mach-Zehnder interferometer. And the similar structure is actually what LIGO used. I don't know if anyone followed the news that LIGO talked about detecting gravitational wave. They actually use this type of setup. But the one that I worked on is very small. LIGO's interferometer covered kilometers. This one can fit in your palms, basically 10 centimeters. And this one is performed with particles. And the sensitivity that you get here can be compared to the sensitivity that you get in light interferometers when you perform the experiments over in the 8 kilometers. And so I will then show you again another visualization here of what happens. So this interferometer is the same interferometer that I showed there. So this is you have the first beam splitter, the mirror, then you have the second beam splitter. Normally you put this as a control agent. You can sweep it and then you change the way the intensity will flow from one port to another. And if you want to measure like a sample, then you have to put it here. And basically what you see here is we have particles coming in when they are split by this beam splitter, and then you have this mirror which reflects it onto this other mirror, and then so onto this beam splitter, and then they get to the detector. So this is a control, and this is the standard 3D interferometer. Just to show you a feel of how it looks like, this is what a system in the laboratory looks like. Kind of complicated. The reason I put this is so you can see what a real setup looks like. So this beam line we constructed when I started my PhD, and it is at the National Institute for Standards of Technology in Maryland. And so this is a relatively new beam line which we constructed based on some new technology, which is part of what I will be explaining. And then here is another set. So we actually have two sets of this, a set of me and this one. This one is much more sophisticated, and this is a sketch of it. So you have the interferometer that I showed, it sits here. And then you see this is a big, you have this building is inside the hall, so you construct another building. It has primary vibration isolation, this six, which isolates it from the foundation of the hall. And then you have, again, a secondary vibration isolation system. So the idea of this is that you want to shield it from noise as much as possible. So moving further, when I started my work, I took down the interferometer, and we want to understand how this single unit works so well. So we take it. So I took it and I said, okay, there are two ways to view it. I take the interferometer and I view it from afar. And what I see is, I basically see three operations. You can think of it as rotations. And because it's a basic unit of quantum information, you can, if you are part of the mathematics, then you can just represent this in a block sphere and perform, like 2x2 matrices, you perform operation in SU2. And this abstraction comes with some properties, which we are saying, we have this the beam splitter, the mirror, and this other beam, which I refer to as blade. It's saying that they are stacked. First of all, they are of equal thicknesses. Then they are also positioned at a periodic location. That's the distance between them is equal. And then you also have rotational invariance. And so by rotational invariance, what it simply means is if you rotate it 180 degrees, it should perform the same. And then the second part is we go into the beam splitter, and then we zoom to see what actually happens inside. When you send a wave and it splits into two, what is actually happening inside? And then abstract it by taking it and splitting it into tiny units. This is actually this, and then we split it, you can further split it. And then it comes also with some assumption that the planes are perfect, you have translational invariance that it occurs at this position, and also rotational invariance. So these properties are coming from actually optimization. So when you take this operation and then you optimize it, you realize that this is one of the conditions that they will perform. And then with that, this will lead us to two projects that I will describe here. One looks like a quantum walk, like a quantum random walk, and then another one will be on like noise free interferometers. So I'll start with talking about a quantum random walk. So if anybody has a computer science background, then they know how to simulate a random walk. And a random walk, a common way to think of it is call it a drunkard walk. You send a particle here. And then we can call this note, we can think of this note as a coin. We toss a coin, we tell the particle go left or go right. Here, it goes left. Or it goes up. And then you toss the coin again, you turn it, okay, now it is a tail, go right. Then you toss the coin again, it's a tail, go right. And then you toss it, say head, go left. And then you keep doing the process. Classically, you can do one process at a time. And And then you come here again and you repeat the process. You will get different measurements on the point. Now, this goes back to what I showed on the first slide, which was classical computation, it takes a single trajectory at a time. Now, if you come to the quantum case, this is what is happening inside the crystal. These trajectories, all of these trajectories happen at once. And then you send a wave here, it splits here, and then this one splits, and the process repeats. And then you generate a wave field here, which is coherent. And this term simply means that all these are happening at once, or you can think of it to say that the phase information is preserved. And then let's have some visualization of what is happening. So we look at, let's go to the classical case again. This is a random walk. The particle comes, moves on one side, keeps bouncing and going. And then it will finally arrive at one of the detectors. Then you come to the quantum case. You see that you cannot tell where the particle is when it is propagating. But what is common to both of them is that only one detector fires at a time. Despite the fact that you cannot tell where the wave is propagating, only one detector will fire. So this is that emphasis. That's the clear distinction between the classical and the quantum case. And then when you look at the intensity distribution or the probability of detecting that the particle arrives, then you look at this. The black lines here shows the distribution here. Like here, I'm assuming that we make it really long enough so that we can compute this distribution. So you see, so in the quantum case, particles would prefer to move to the edges. So the variance here is much more larger. And in the classical case, you see that the particle, you have a higher probability of seeing the particle, detecting the particle in the center. And this actually is used a lot in building quantum algorithms, and that is why some of the algorithms will outperform classical algorithms. So we took this process now, and then we look at different experiments that you can perform, like do this measurements to see, because we came out with this model and want to see how it actually sort of like what experiments predict or what comes out of the experiment if it actually coincides with what experiments are saying. So we have, you take this and you split it into n units. I'm assuming you can continually split it. When you take n equals to 100, this is what you see, and then as you increase n, you see the intensity keeps increasing. And this is what you expect to see in the standard experiment. So these first three measurements are the distribution of this beam profile. And then on this beam profile, you have this one for n equals to 100, n equals to 1,000, and this is what you expect to see. So you see that the reflected beam is symmetric. And the one that is transmitted tends to peak at the edge. And this is more of, comes from the choice of operator that you pick. Like the operator that I pick here is the Hadamard operator, 2x2 matrix that you see. Then you also move forward to compare it with some experimental data again. So this is results of the simulation. Is if you sum here to be like, if I sum all of these probabilities and then I change n, how does it behave? So why we are doing this is because we are performing an optimization. We want to know the exact thickness that when you stack this to form an interferometer, the best performing thickness. So that's why we're summing here and getting this. And this is some experimental data that I compared with. This data actually is from the 1960s. So now I will take you to noise-free interferometry, which, as I said, the idea, we want to look at how we can encode information, understand a simple system that will perform well. And what we did here, we use here mostly is, this is a standard interferometer that I showed you all through. And I said, this interferometer sits in this system. System is really, really sophisticated, and it's very bulky and also very expensive to construct. And for that reason, you only have Actually, there are only two of these systems that exist in the world that are functional. One at the National Institute for Standards and Technology, and one at the Institute Laurent Langevin in Grenoble in France. And one of the reasons is because you need, these are all custom made. And because of that, you need, and they are also very sophisticated, as I mentioned. This is like a room within a room, isolated. You have to isolate it. So now, we use the techniques that are developed for quantum information, which we call the quantum error correction. And the basic understanding behind it is that, just like for classical error correction, you take a system, rather than building a system like this, which you take this system and you build this system, and then you try to engineer the environment where it sits in such a way that you isolate it from noise. We use quantum error correction to build a system which rather will survive in a noisy environment. So if you have an environment that is not completely isolated like this, then we can have a device that can operate in that environment and function well. And the idea behind it is first going to understand the symmetry in this system, understanding why this system actually works and why it works the way it does. So we designed this interferometer, which is now different. This one had a beam splitter, mirror, and then another beam splitter. This one has a beam splitter, a mirror, ignore these ones. And then you have another beam splitter, another mirror, and another beam splitter. So as a result of this, this one has one loop. There's a loop here, this one has two loops. There's a loop here, and there's a loop here. And let's view, how the neutrons propagate through this. So if we then tested this system to look at how they will, you can compare this system with this system in a noisy environment, because the idea here is that you want to show that this system is much more robust to noise. So by encoding information in this subspace, you can actually show this information from specific, it's actually a specific class of noise. And so the quantity that we will use here to compare their performance is called the visibility. And visibility is basically when you look at the intensity here and you vary this phase flux, the intensity will oscillate. So you look at you extract the maximum and the minimum, and then you normalize it. So we start. And both of them, they start at the maximum. And then as you get noise into the system, you realize that the visibility here will fall quite quickly. I'll do that again. So this interferometer clearly is performing better than this in a noisy environment. So by doing that, What we are looking forward to is that rather than having these systems that are sophisticated and expensive and difficult to construct, which comes also with a lot of problems, because this needs to be isolated from vibration. This is inside the nuclear reactor, building the nuclear reactor. So you have to keep it very far from the source. And when you keep it very far from the source, it also means that you will lose most of the intensity. The source is actually giving you very little intensity. And when you lose the intensity, it means you will need to perform the experiment for a very longer time to get a very good signal to noise ratio. So by designing this system, we can then set the experiment on a tabletop. This is a commercial table. So you can take this, rather than building this, we'll just put it here. And so the current setup that we have, the first picture that I showed you two system, one system now sits on this. So here is some actual real experimental data. So to perform the experiment, we actually took the two interferometers and we set it up. The experiment was performed in the beam line that is completely isolated from noise. And then you put the interferometer, you set it up, and then you put a mechanical system, which basically vibrates and moves the table. So when there is no noise in the system, you have this is the intensity part. In the foveated interferometer, you will have this intensity part. And then when you set noise, so what I'm showing here is actually just the count that you detect here. So when you set noise to 8 hertz, the frequency 8 hertz, you see that you don't have the visibility, which is normalize the distance, or you can think of it just as the difference, the height of this button. You lose it. And here is still data. So this data actually just for the actually that's the data that we use to show that this performs more than that. And as every system that you build, you always find some complication in it. There's always a problem which you also have to solve. So we notice that this here basically simulations. I took a three blade again and I simulated to show that this performs more than this. But then I told you that when you view the interferometer from a global picture, you see it as three. I put it as three different rotations, and I said the conditions are that they are of equal thicknesses, and then they are also positioned in a periodic order. So you have the distance between them is equal. When you look at the three plates, you actually have that. They have this and this and this. They are placed in a periodic order. You look at the four plates, the distance between this and this is not the same. So you have a different distance here from here to here. So what happens now is that one mathematician will say you've broken translational invariance. So it is a symmetry inside. So by breaking that symmetry, it comes with a cost. So we had one loop here and we tried to introduce two loops here. So the way this remove noise that I showed previously is that you put, if noise, you view noise like this circle, here you have noise here, the noise there. Here you introduce noise in this loop, and then in the other loop you introduce noise in an opposite direction. That is how the noise shows up. And that is why it refocuses noise for vibration. But because this distance is different from this, we've broken that symmetry and it comes with a cost. And that cost means that we don't have, actually when you perform the experiment, you don't have the maximum visibility that you expect. Just like in the experimental data that I showed earlier, if actually you calculate the visibility here and the visibility here, you will realize that the visibility here is slightly higher than this. We are considering that they are sitting in a perfect center.
I have a question. How you variate the input? I mean, when you do these experiments, I guess you repeat them between 3, 4, and 5 plates with the same type of input.
Yes.
Do you do then a variation of the input?
So you have, the input is just a stream of particles that are coming. So you take one set of, just like as I showed in the animation, you take one and then you put, and then you set the input, so the particles that you are shooting, they are continuous.
Doesn't matter the angle?
So I didn't get into that, but the angle matters.
Okay.
Yeah, it's more of the complexity that I was trying to stay away from.
Okay.
Because everything that operates here, like, that's why, like, I draw this in angle. You have to ensure that this angle is perfect, or this angle, this is actually a specific angle, which you normally refer to as, this is Bragg diffraction, so that's the Bragg angle. So you need to send them exactly at that angle. And part of the reason, actually, it's a good question, because part of the reason why breaking this symmetry affects the interferometer is because of that angle. So you have that angle, and because when you have this angle, the symmetry of this interferometer, which is a periodicity of the blade, doesn't show up. But when you break that symmetry, then the effect of the angles shows up, because at each angle, it picks a face. And then each of them picks different faces. And then when you add this, it becomes random, because like they're picking different faces. And that counts on the angle. So we designed this other interferometer, which there are two loops in it. Like you have this loop and you have this loop. And then you there is an additional blade in the middle. So the additional blade now brings back the symmetry, like the symmetry of the blade that you have, while maintaining the symmetry of the blade. And that also comes with the cost that we need to have now, these two phase tracks, which you have to configure them at a specific angle. So this is,
So when you're talking about like rotational invariance, is it in absolute space, or are we talking about rotations within the system? So like relative to each other, the pieces are moving.
So I showed to you the piece that I showed to you that I said can fit on a top. It's basically cut for a single. It's actually like you take a silicon crystal and then you chop it off so that you have these three blades that are sitting parallel to one another. So it's a solid figure. Okay,
so
rotational invariance here is the whole structure
rotating,
moving in space. Each of these, the blades cannot move on their own.
Yeah, that's the weird thing about like why would it matter? Like just to a natural sort of understanding, you kind of assume rotational asymmetry or symmetry rather.
It's not always
or anything. But
no,
in the quantum space.
No, it's not always. No, you don't always get it. It's not. It's like intuitively you would think that. So this is not rotation by 360.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe that's the case. Here, like you can distinguish this.
Right.
The rotation here is by 180. So if I rotate it like this, it's clearly different,
yes.
Right? The laser is here and
yes.
This other side is different. So rotation here is 180. But even if you are rotating it by 360, in the quantum system, it is not true that when you rotate by 360, you will get the same configuration. Okay, so hopefully I tried to convince you that I had something useful for you today. So I showed you a basic quantum system, and I showed how you can take a wave and simulate its propagation through a periodic crystal in terms of quantum work. And then I also showed you how you can design noise-free interferometry. So part of this work was done when I was doing my PhD, and the experiments were performed in the National Institute of Standards and Technology, which is a national lab in Maryland. And this is a picture of the institute where I spent my time as a PhD student. And the work, a lot of collaboration with the work here. And the animations were also done here. Most of the animations were done here. And some of the pictures I took them from online where you can see references here. Okay, thank you very much for coming.
So these are used to build, real quantum computers, yeah?
So, just to be careful here, we are not going to use a neutron interferometer to build a quantum computer. We are going to use some other implementation, like superconducting qubits, to build a quantum computer, or to build a quantum processor. But if you take a single qubit that is implemented with a superconducting qubit, or it is implemented maybe with a silicon phosphorus or with a spin, the mathematics is the same, the abstraction is the same. So when at that basic unit, you can perform experiments that will help you understand how another one will perform if you don't have access to this information. But to build a quantum computer, it will be implemented in a different system, not this. But this one, as I was trying to convince you, it has some other useful elements that are coming with it.
I've always wondered how exactly do you make beam splitter? How do you ensure that there's exactly 50-50 chance that the beam goes in one direction?
So it depends on the system that you are working with. And in most cases, you can never ensure that you have exactly 50-50. Maybe you have, let's say, 49-50, right? But then in this system, we don't have 50-50. And there is one of the projects that I worked on which was more of optimizing to see if we can get 50-50. So this project, you perform the optimization of the whole rather than optimizing a single unit. So when you optimize the whole, then you can have 50-50 beam at the output. But if you look at the performance of each of it, it's not actually 50-50. But you can optimize to, it doesn't affect the measurement because it's more of, they call it, it's just an asymmetry, which when you perform measurements, you can renormalize to get that.
Right, so you just sort of try it on size and average them.
Yeah, exactly. Like these crystals are cut, you cut this crystal and in, so this, the one of our works actually shows that if you have an offset which is of like micrometers, then you cannot have, that it will affect how much splitting occurs. And so the challenge is we have that fabrication limitation. So when you say that, okay, I want exactly cut a crystal of this thickness, what something else will come from the machine shop. And you know, when they cut, you still have to clean the surface. And you have to use some other tools that can probably remove a few nanometer layers. And as a result of that, you might end up with a different thickness. And the thickness is actually what, the thickness in combination with the wavelength tells you how much will go in each of the directions. And then as he was asking about the angle, there will always be a distribution. The question is, how do you select this particle and send in and short particles flowing in? There is another process before the particles are getting into the interferometer. Like I showed a huge setup. You send a stream of particles that are flowing, and then you select some, the ones that are important to you, and you select it with diffraction. And you cannot select, the diffraction provides not a delta function. And delta function is basically tiny strip. We show that you have exactly one wavelength. No, it's a distribution that has a width. So you would, if you want to say, let's say you want to select a wavelength of everything like light, like that's easier to say that you want to select a wavelength of, let's say 640 nanometers, you might end up selecting maybe from 635 to 644. So you have a spread of wavelengths within. And because you have that spread, you realize that if your nominal wavelength is 640, then you optimize your beam splitter to 640, but then you have other side wavelengths.
Yeah, I understand it's not practical to build a quantum computer using a neutron source, but doesn't that it have the advantage over like other technologies like supercomputing? Like the squids, that the squid loses coherence quickly, whereas this one doesn't lose coherence. And if that's the case, then isn't there, what's the limit of the number of qubits that you can build? You wouldn't want to put neutron source in every office, but if there is an advantage, like in the old days, you know,
and I will list the five. Because basically what's happening is that you can implement a qubit. It's just a degree of freedom like that operates in a quantum perspective. So here I showed you have split as it goes into two. I can abstract that in terms of momentum by saying, telling you that let's go back to this. So I can just say that if you send this, I can put an axis here and say that an axis is going up, you have an axis pointing up. So the state that is going up is propagating in the positive direction, and the one that is coming down is propagating in the negative direction. I use that positive and negative to abstract my 0 and 1. That's 1A qubit. A neutron has a property of quantum physics that you said it has a spin. It's a property that, just like mass, I cannot describe it before, it's just like mass. You can polarize a neutron and then it will have a spin. So you can control the speed of the neutron. If you control the speed, then that's another degree of freedom. And then you can put these devices that can manipulate the speed. Or we can, rather than using silicon here, as I showed the silicon interferometer, we can make an interferometer from a magnetic material. So the neutron going here will have different speed. Then we can also have the path degree of freedom. Sorry, the displacement degree of freedom. And that displacement is, you take the interferometer, and this is the plane of the interferometer with this coming in. You see, you split the beams in a horizontal position. You can actually put some elements that will split it out of the plane, right? And then that gives you another additional degree of freedom. and then you can slow it down to say that rather than having a wave packet that propagates and arrives at the same time, you can slow it down so you have this another degree of freedom. And I told you here that you should ignore I told you that you should ignore this. So look here, something that I'm not showing you is this is a silicon crystal, this is a silicon crystal, this is a silicon crystal. Why is it that it's hit here and rather here in reflection? Actually it's not true. It actually repeats the same process here. Because it's the same crystal. The reason I'm showing you this is because what goes off here never makes it to the detector, and for mathematics, renormalizing the system is equivalent to just forgetting about whatever runs away. After all, it never existed. It never existed. So in that case now, if you take control of what is going here, and now this, let's make use of this, then here it splits into two components, right? The one that splits here will reach here. And what happens? This guy will split it too. So at the end, you have multiple loops. You have a loop here, you have another loop here, you have another loop here. So that will give you, so abstracting information in terms of the trajectories that you take, that will give you multiple systems. So I cannot just tell you exactly how many can be implemented, but I know that we had a poster that we showed how you can do 5.